Thoughts this morning about Jesus being the captain of our salvation. And I know it's probably nothing new to any of you, but as we've talked about before, it's always good to rehearse these things and to go over and remind us of who we are in Christ and what he has done for us. So this was God's intent from the very beginning, of course. First Peter 1:20 to 21 says, "He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Amen. All is ordained by the Lord for our good, to bring us to himself." Of course, that is if man will reciprocate. Not everyone, you know, will accept his invitation. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." So that is his desire, that everyone would come to him. He has made provision for all, you know, to come. And he is very good and gracious, and has so arranged for man to seek him, as Paul preached to the Athenians. He said, "And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. Mm-hmm. For in him we live and move and have our being." Amen. And I remember the first time that I understood that, you know, just realizing the detail that God orchestrates in our life, you know, for our good towards him. And, you know, that's very encouraging in your faith, you know, to actually realize that. And this has all been a plan since, like we said, before the foundation of the world. It wasn't something that he's making up as he goes or has thought about as a second plan that didn't work in the first place. This was all, he has had this all planned all along.
Amen.
Even while we were still in our sin and enemies, Jesus was willing to go to this extent. I read from Romans 5, 6 to 9. "Therefore, having been justified by faith, for we were still without strength. In due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." Mm-hmm. So you know, you have heard stories, I'm sure I have too, I'm sure, of people, like even in war times or something like that, would take someone's place to die because they thought they were worthy of that, and to save them for their family or to raise children or whatever. But God died, I mean, Jesus died for the ungodly even. I mean, who today would be willing to die for someone that they felt like, you know, was worthless? But he did that beforehand, hoping that we would come to him. This wrath that is mentioned here is inevitable for everyone. So that is what is going to be due to all of us, unless we come to Jesus, who is the Savior of our souls. Of course, Jesus said, "I am the door, I am the way to the Father." Because of his willing sacrifice, we are not condemned. And you're all real familiar with this verse, I'm sure, from Romans 8. "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death." He has made us free indeed. I always think of that old hymn that talks about that we've sang many times. We are indebted to him for bringing us to God. And in turn, we render ourselves, our whole selves, back to him. In Hebrews, the second chapter, verses 9 and 10, it says, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings." Amen. So he is in all and over all, and is the captain of our salvation, like I had entitled this. He is precious to us, and we will praise him for it. 1 Peter 2, 7-8 says, "Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense." So depending on whether you have faith and love him, whether he is precious to you or not. He's the smell of death to others who are not, of course. Brother Gibbon mentioned the other night about the natural order of things, that thankfulness and praise does not come first. We have to see him for who he is, for what he has done for us, with these eyes of spiritual eyes of understanding, and then the praise will naturally come forth. It's not an orchestrated thing. It's not a learned thing. It's just the natural reaction to what he has done. So I want to close this with this verse that talks about that. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into this marvelous light, his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
Amen.
So it's good to remember those things.
Smart.